there's one common thread that we all share that unites us and connects us to each other. And I was in a car a few weeks ago and I spoke to the pastor and I told him, you know, I struggled to get this word out because I didn't feel qualified. And out of wisdom, he gave me something that gave me the confidence to continue to go forward and get this word out. He said, you know what, son? We're not qualified, but it's him who qualifies us. Yeah. And that's what I needed to hear. So I want to try to minister to you. This is case-sensitive information because I struggled all my life, not portions, all my life in some area or another. And so today I want to minister on the final exam of struggling. Look at your neighbor and say, the final exam of struggle. If you're going to get to that level of being blessed and having favor as our pastor and being graced, then you have to pass the final exam of struggle. All right. I'm going to get right into the word. Deuteronomy. Can't even say that right. How do you say that? Deuteronomy. Okay. Deuteronomy 8, verses 2 through 5. And this is the only time I ask you to stand on your feet as accustomed to the word of God. I'll read as fast as I can. And like Pastor, I like to speak with authority and be a little animated. So we're going to be a little animated today. And the word says, and you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and test you, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. The man of God just said that. So he humbled you, allowed you to be hungry, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers, that he might make you to know that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. Your garments, in other words, what you wore, did not wear out on you, nor, I'm from Georgia, this is how they say it in Georgia, the older folks, your footsies swelled these 40 years. Amen. Think about that, 40 years. You're wearing the same thing every day, and it did not wear out on you. And you're walking in your sandals, they ain't have shoes like this. You're walking in your sandals. They probably were doing about 7-8 miles a day, young and old, and it didn't wear out. I don't know about y'all, but I like Jordans, and after 6 months of playing basketball, my Jordans, they wear out. All right. Verse 5. You shall know in your heart that as a man chastens his son, so the Lord your God chastens you. Yeah. Yeah. Right. He does it because he loves us. Yeah. Whooping saved my life. Let me tell you how. If your kid acting bad, I'm 34 years old, it will save their life, I'm telling you. Anyway, let me get in the word. See, it is the struggle that defines the foundation to believe. There's a blueprint that your struggles follow. They build your character. They build and structure how you believe. Struggling is a motor. It's a master motor. It's a chief architect at crafting the intangibles into tangibles. Your pains, your afflictions, your setbacks, your heartbreaks, and your disasters have all been employed and hired by God. They've been ordered into your life. He chose that particular thing or things to build and develop more quality out of you. He handpicked your pains, watch this, to make you more resilient and flexible so that you'll be more compassionate and flexible to others who are suffering with the same things. So in other words, God handpicked them to build you up. As minister said, let me give you somebody. Psalms. Psalms 37, 23 through 24. I'm on my lips. Chalk up and stick. It says, watch this, here's a qualification. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Y'all caught that?
Come on now. Come on, yeah.
The qualifications is what? The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not utterly be cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. How did that interpret to us? Although you fail, he says you're not a failure. As long as you fall and you keep trying, he says I'll pick you up again. He says, as long as you give it another chance, after chance, after chance, after chance. He says, what I'm delighted in is this, that the fact that you will not quit. That's what he's delighted about. It's not how many times you fail or you sin. As long as you get back up and try again, he says, he will uphold you. See, the thing about molding is this, you're not in control of the process. When you're being molded, this is what I learned. It's a repeating, a cycle, a circle of the same things. God, why do I keep going through this? And being molded. God, why do I keep going through the same person? I left this person. I'm with this person. God, the same. It's a cycle of repeating over and over again. See, potters, when they start out, it's always muddy and inelegant and nasty. You ever notice that? There are times where God will use your ugly struggles to mold you. Because the outcome is up to us. Whether we come out ugly or beautiful has everything to do with how we respond. Somebody come. My first point. You're going to be quizzed with struggles. If you want to know if you have hope or faith or not, you're going to have to prove that with being quizzed with some type of struggle. No one likes struggle, but everybody likes the media that struggle draw. If you want free marketing and advertisement, get in some type of struggle. Because struggle is free advertisement. Reporters never come out until there's some type of struggle. Your life's reporters aren't going to come out until you're struggling. Your struggling does one of three things. Number one, your struggle can be relatable. When it's relatable, what that does is it gives you credibility to reach somebody else. Number two, your struggle can be detestable. When it's detestable, it destroys your credibility with people. Number three, your struggle can be inspirational. When it's inspirational, what that does is it causes people to try instead of quit. You become a source of inspiration to people. So your struggle is going to lead to one of those three things. It's going to either be relatable, detestable, or inspirational. See, we pay money to see a drama about struggles. Me and my wife, well, I'm telling myself, we just went to see Mockingjay Part 2. We paid money to go to the movies about struggle. We pay to listen to people's music about struggle. We support organizations and charities that donate and assist to others who are struggling. But get this, we never, come here, Pastor. When we see them struggling, we never partner with somebody who's struggling. Those who are weak, in that case me, those who are strong, I'm sorry, need to bear the infirmities of the people. Genesis 32, 24 through 28. You don't have to read. You don't have to read. We're not going to even go there. But I want to talk about Jacob real quick. Jacob struggled. He struggled with his identity. He struggled with a bad reputation.
Yep.
Watch this. He struggled in his marriage between two sisters and two sex slaves.
Yeah.
He struggled with his brother, and he struggled with his father.
Yeah.
And watch this, like me, he struggled all his life. Jacob got touched in his hip. So now how he moves and how he walks is extremely limited because it's dislocated. Some struggles God will place on you that you can't be delivered from. That you will have this ailment for the rest of your life. I'm not going to leave you in a place of hopelessness. See, my favorite quote is this. My own. Is this. Pressure is the necessary ingredient in productivity. Pressure is the necessary ingredient in productivity. If you want to be productive, you have to be pressured. See, many times, in order to be productive, God would allow us to be limited and dysfunctional in some area. See, everything in Jacob's life was a pivotal point to see, was he going to quit or was he going to be desperate enough to trust God? Was he going to allow some pain to affect his future? Let me ask you a question. Are you going to allow some pain to affect your future? What God has for you? I'll go one higher. Are you going to allow some pressure to affect your future and rob you of everything God has for you? Carmen Contrell said this: the greatest inspiration is often born of desperation. See, it is how desperate you are that will provoke the change that can change your whole life. See, many times change doesn't come because we're not desperate enough. So God will allow us to stay in that. You know what?
Gotta catch it.
See, what happens is desperation fathers emptiness. I'm trying to give you the illustration. Desperation fathers emptiness. Bishop Jake said this. Emptiness provokes filling. Emptiness provokes filling. Thank you. See, you can't be filled unless you have the capacity for it. The emptier you are, the more space you have for filling. See, the thing about poor people is this. They don't want nothing from God. They don't need nothing from God. You know why? Because they are content with what they have and where they're at. Now, I know the scripture says, Apostle Paul, be content with what state you're in. But sometimes, if you want a little more from God, you got to learn how to get a little empty. Because that's going to provoke God's feeling. Because of your struggles, I want to mention something. I'm telling you, I struggled to get this out because I struggled.
All right.
Some people who think that God has forgotten about you, He has a response for you.
Go ahead, Brandon.
Psalms 9 and 18, this is what it says. All right. This is what it says. For the needy shall not always be forgotten. In other words, I haven't forgotten about you. The expectation of the poor shall not perish forever. So the thing or things you've been expecting, it will not perish for the course of your life. At some point in your life, if you keep being empty, if you keep being empty, it's attractive to God. Let me tell you why. God is full. But watch this. He enjoys filling. Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle. After, get this, you have struggled a while. Your timing, my God, thank you. Your timing has everything to do with how desperate you are. If you ain't desperate, you're gonna stay here. But if you get desperate and you start to call, the sufferings and your struggles will perfect the areas of dislocation that God touched. Then God will establish you, and then he'll make you stable and able to handle everything that comes in life successfully. Then he will strengthen you, and afterwards, many times, get this is important, you will be as a doctor. Watch this. Through your passing this exam, you now become a specialist in that area. Because you passed that exam and you know the pains and you know how it functions and you know how it's been dislocated and you studied and you've been desperate, you can now be somebody else's solution. Because you specialize in healing them. You will cure them. You can play the song. Your life is the necessary research to someone else's cure. Say that again. Some people who struggle, your life is the necessary research to someone else's cure. The storms you face is going to help somebody else go on. God built you stormproof. He made you able to handle the many pressures and and watch this, and the many things, and watch this, as you endure that, you now become someone else's solution. He made you to handle it. And as you learn how to handle the very thing that brought you so much pain, so much frustration, so much depression, will be somebody else's solution. Turn it up just a little bit more. Just a little bit. I wanted to minister to you. See, your problems are important because your problems are the seeds for your rewards. Without a problem, we wouldn't have a job. And the truth is, your problems are the seeds for your own solution. Your storms, your problems, your circumstances are someone's solution. And as you pass this test, you're going to get rewarded. Because you can help heal so many wounded people. Watch this. Only if you take your eyes off of your own hurts. Yes, sir. Pastor, can you stand up here? Pastor, can you stand up? Yes. This is hurts. That's God. You've been looking at what's hurting you for too long. You've been looking at what's pulling you down for too long. The scripture says, looking unto Jesus, Hebrews 12 and 2, who is the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So what you got to do, you got to take your eyes off of this. And you got to start going, try to get in my way, try to distract me. And you got to start looking unto Jesus. Because the more you look to him, watch this, he's drawing you closer. And when it gets too close to God, it's going to get out your way.
You got it.
trying to work it out without consulting him. He says, come to me that I may give you rest. He says, I know you're in trouble. I know you're in debt. I know you're enslaved to something. But I designed your problems. And I designed and ordered your pain so that you would stop trusting in people and stop trusting in things and stop trusting in education and learn how to trust in me.
Slave to death and a slave to all types of things.
says this. Here's your key. Here's your word. Stand still. Come here, Sterling. Stand still. I know they got weapons. I know they're coming to kill you. I know these bills are piling up. I know the eviction and all this stuff is coming in. And you trying to do. He says, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. And the enemies you see today, you will see no longer. Forevermore.
Let me tell you something. Don't just come up gingerly.
You got to come up expecting and believing that this is your time. That he's going to give you the curve to where you can get past that sameness and that recycling of going through the same thing over and over again. I'm telling you, come get your charge in the Holy Ghost and get past that place. It wasn't until I started believing what God was offering in this man of God. And I started coming with expectation. He spoke, the wait is over. If you believe your wait is over, we want you to come forward.
Come on, you've been struggling with something, something that you're going through. The Lord said, your time. It is your time. Just come on. You're going through for a reason. But God is not finished with you. God has a plan for your pain, for your struggle. God has called you here today so that you can get the victory. You hear a word that allow you to let you know that many other afflictions are the righteous, but the Lord delivered them out of them all. And so today the Lord is saying to you, just come as you are. Give me your heart. Give me you. And allow me to take you to the next place. If that's you, please come. Go right on down here.
Give it all to you.